We'll take a 2-minute break, just so, because we need to rearrange the chairs a little bit, it's a bit cramped, and maybe if the empty seats and people who are standing want to squeeze in. I would encourage everyone to please have the refreshments that are there in this little break on the left over there. And then after that, we have our introducer introduce Professor Robert Warrior.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you very much.
My name is Cecilia Sierra, and I'm a member of the Transnational Solidarity Initiative. It is my pleasure to introduce today's introducer. He happens to be also one of our faculty advisors for the Transnational Solidarity Initiative. Julie Bird, I don't think she needs a presentation, but I will do my best. She is an associate professor of American Indian Studies, English, Gender and Women's Studies. And she's also the author of this extraordinary book, The Transit of Empire, which, if you haven't read it yet, I highly recommend you to get a copy of it and do it as soon as possible. So I think that tonight both Julie and Robert have said more time than I do, so I will just let Julie introduce Robert.
The person we want to hear is Robert, so I'll be as brief and quick as possible. But before I introduce Professor Robert Allen Warrior, we'll be giving the 2014 Edward W. Said Memorial Lecture here at the University of Illinois tonight. I want to first acknowledge the graduate students and faculty who made this event possible through this year's focal point, and through generous and creative mobilizing to generate relevant programming for our campus in light of what Professor Warrior has called the Mobility Gate. Last spring, graduate students, including Esty and Katapia, along with faculty mentors in history, sociology, anthropology, and American Indian studies, organized a focal point entitled Rethinking Transnationalism in the Age of Mediatized Social Uprisings, to invite scholars to campus to discuss, quote, the transnational networks of solidarity as sought out, actualized, and maintained by activists, educators, organizations, public intellectuals, and seemingly anonymous protesters, unquote. One of the many consequences of Chancellor Wise's decision to unhire Stephen Salida this fall, and as many of you know, is that the boycott by scholars outside our institution has made it difficult for students to fulfill the projects that, up until August 1st, had so much potential to transform this campus through conversations about the profound effects of globality on how we apprehend difference, oppression, and solidarity on this campus. While the Chancellor's actions have created the conditions that have resulted in outside scholars refusing to engage this campus through formal speaking engagements, he has also created the opportunity for us here to speak to each other about our own work on these issues, especially as they impact humanities, a project that, according to Palestinian scholar Edward Said, has always been, quote, a means of questioning, upsetting, and reformulating so much of what is presented to us as commodified, packaged, uncontroversial, and uncritically codified certainties, including those contained in the masterpieces herded under the rubric of the classics. Robert Warrior is Director of American Indian Studies here at the University of Illinois, where he is also a professor of American Indian Studies, English, and History. He is an enrolled member of the Osage Nation, and his work, including Tribal Secrets, Recovering American Indian Intellectual Traditions, Like a Hurricane, the Indian Movement from Alcatraz to Wounded Knee with Paul Chott Smith, The People and the Word, Reading Native Nonfiction, and American Indian Literary Nationalism that he co-authored with Craig Womack and Jace Wheeler, have played an inaugural role in building the current field of American Indian Studies. As one of the original founders of the Native American and Indigenous Studies Association, Professor Warrior has worked tirelessly to support Indigenous scholars internationally and to help build a world-renowned disciplinary association for those scholars to meet and share their work. Before joining the faculty of Illinois, he was Edith Kinney Gaylord Presidential Professor at the University of Oklahoma, and he has also served as faculty at Cornell University and Stanford University. He received his PhD from Union Theological Seminary and his MA from Yale University. A student of Edward Said, Professor Warrior's recent work has sought to expand the horizons of indigenous intellectual health through modes that embrace creativity, experimentation, and critical theory. His talk tonight is entitled, Remembering Said's Minority Imperative and the Persistence of Lost Causes.
Thank you all. very much. Thanks for being here. I hope you can hear me. And without apologizing for what I do tonight, this was going to be a roundtable. Someone may have told you at some point, and I was going to participate on it. And as the roundtable became less and less round, we said we still have one rotund person left. we'll ask him, if you will, to fill in as the Edward Said Memorial Lecturer, and who could pass on a chance at that, especially me as a student of Edward Said. And so I gladly accepted the honor of being able to deliver this lecture without quite enough time to be able to turn it into something as quite as formed as I'd maybe like it to be, but I'm still very honored to do so. And then Esty made this beautiful poster and made me even more glad that I'd accepted the honor of having done it. So I want to thank the students for having done that. I also would like to just issue a very personal and heartfelt thank you to everyone who's here and everyone who's not here on this campus, who's been so wonderful about supporting me and my colleagues at American Indian Studies over the past couple of months, as we have confronted what's been a very difficult situation. And it's been difficult not only for us, but for many of you as well, for all of you, I would dare say, in light of the Chancellor's decision to unhire my friend and colleague, Stephen Salida. I wish that he was here tonight delivering this lecture instead of me. I wish that his wife and his son were here on campus with us, enjoying the life of community, intellectual community, and bringing people in all over, from all over, to be part of that community. In light of all of that, we've come together in an unprecedented way to face an unprecedented situation. And I remember saying to a couple of people a few days after that initial decision, when it was first of all just me and Jody and Fred Hoxie and Matt Gilbert, that first weekend was incredibly confusing, incredibly difficult to figure out what was going on and how to respond. And by the next weekend, when there were a lot of people writing in and doing other things, I said, this is so much better than last weekend because we're not alone. And they said, you know, Robert, you're not alone and you won't be. And everybody on this campus has proven that. It's been a wonderful part of what's been a truly awful experience. So thank you to everyone, from me especially, but also my colleagues in American Indian Studies. One of the things that I thought about even before accepting this invitation from the Transnational Focal Point Group, something that was on my mind even before what happened to Stephen and what happened to our program, as someone who is deeply influenced by Edward Said, was that he had already been on my mind over the summer during the Israeli military assault on Gaza, and then even more often as AIS found itself in the midst of the controversy that we did find ourselves in. I had a recurring memory of Said's famous stone-throwing incident from 2000 throughout the controversy. As some of you will remember, that 3 years before he died, about 3 years before Said made this wonderful lecture at the University of Washington, he let fly a rock across the Lebanese-Israeli frontier from southern Lebanon into Israel. The moment was captured by a photographer and disseminated first in the Israeli press and then in the U.S., which, of course, delighted his adversaries to see this picture of Said throwing a stone across the frontier. He was defended by his provost, thank goodness, and many others, but the incident in which no one was ever in danger of being harmed was one of those moments that got Said, earning Said the moniker the Professor of Terror. And this alleged act of terror and the controversy it prompted had him being accused of being an anti-Semite, being anti-Israeli, of course. And it led literally to things like the Freud Society in Vienna caving into external pressure and sending an invitation to him to give a lecture there later that year. The invitation was sent to him after the incident. The external pressure was applied after the invitation was accepted by him, given the title to his lecture, and then the external pressure started, and then the invitation was withdrawn. As he pointed out later, the many other places around the world said, well, we want to hear that lecture on Freud. So other Freud societies and other places. But the one in Vienna, that main one at the Freud Museum in Vienna, wouldn't have him come. That insult, as many others over the years, were ones that are of course incredibly disappointing for what amounts to this very small act of him picking up a rock and throwing it across the Lebanese Israeli border. Many things that he says in this lecture that we just heard are of course more inflammatory, if you'd like to think of it that way, than throwing a rock across the border, that are nearly as inflammatory to say in public as things people now say on Twitter, say on Facebook. I wonder how this would play as a job talk at any number of universities around the country. What kind of reaction some of the things that Saeed says that are easily defensible as statements about Israel and about the United States would prompt as part of a discussion about his hireability in a number of places. They're easily defensible. He points out that place where he threw that rock from was a spot that was, in fact, Israel's gateway 22 years earlier in its invasion of Lebanon, a place, an invasion that killed 22,000 Lebanese people in 1982. And it was just a mile away from Qiyam prison where 8,000 people had faced torture during Israel's occupation of southern Lebanon. So the great irony, he picks up a rock and throws it. The world notices, and he has to defend himself. He has to spend weeks, if not months, living out the controversy over throwing a rock across the border. And yet those people in the United States don't know what Qiyam prison is. They don't remember the Israeli invasion of Lebanon. They don't remember those 22,000 people who were killed. It doesn't stick anywhere in their minds. And yet a lot of people probably do remember that image of Saeed. Well, many of you remember Saeed throwing the rock, and I wanted to share with some of you the things that I remember about Saeed that maybe others of you don't remember. Many of you probably heard Saeed in a lecture hall like the one that we saw tonight, saw that wonderful command of the language, both written and then also when he would read the pages he did, the incredible command of the language, but also of the facts, the politics, the history around colonialism, the history of the occupation of the U.S., the way that he is able, at one and the same time, to be one of the most intelligent people that you would ever hear, that you would ever meet, and also so thoroughly a Palestinian person who is carrying forward the story of a people, carrying forward life of a people, being part of the life of a people, a representative really of the national life of the Palestinian people in dispossession in this way that he was a part of that 20th and the 21st century history. I was fortunate that I got to know Edward Saeed not only in that kind of setting but also as a teacher. I always feel as though I'm a little bit of a poser, but not quite a poser, because I wasn't a graduate student who Edward Saeed was on my graduate committee that I wrote a dissertation for him and he read every chapter and sent me back comments and I went to his office and said, what classes should I take? But I did take classes from him and I did actually go to his office and sit down with him and ask him questions, and I would stop him on the street and I'd say, Professor Saeed, and he'd go, oh, Robert. Stop and we'd talk for a few minutes, and those were some of the greatest times of my life. Got together and talked in his office were treasured moments for me. He did, in fact, write for me when I got my first job at Stanford as an English professor, and I don't know how much it helped. All I know is that the six people who didn't think I belonged to be in the English department at Stanford, the same six people who didn't think I belonged as a tenured professor in that department, and those were the same six people whose opinion mattered the most, so I was denied tenure. But I did appreciate him writing his letter at the time. But I really remember his classroom, and this wasn't an accident that I ended up on the Upper West Side of Columbia. I had lots of opportunities to try to go different places. One of the reasons I decided to go to Union Theological Seminary to do my graduate work is because Edward Said was there, and I had become familiar with his work. I had learned about it, and it had become important to me because I had already been to Palestine by that time. In the summers of 1984 and 1985, I had become a volunteer for the government of Israel and had been an archaeological volunteer at a site at the top of Yom Kinneret or the Sea of Galilee, digging up a Roman bathhouse and other complex of buildings at the top of the lake. Much preferable archaeological site to places in the Negev desert where you would dig in the desert all day and then you'd go back to a youth hostel in the middle of the desert and then you'd go back to the desert to dig back to the youth hostel in the middle of the desert. We would hang out on our archaeological site by day and then go back to Tiberias at night to a resort hostel and hang out there, and that was a very nice place to be. But that was my introduction both to Israel, to the West Bank, to Gaza, and in my second summer that I did this, I also got to spend a significant amount of time with Arab Israelis in a place that some of you may know of if you've ever been to Israel, if you're from Israel, if you're from the West Bank of Palestine, the Arab world, called Ramla, which is a village that's inside of Israel. And I got to know a lot of the young people who were there. Sometimes when I do an event like this, I feel as though there have got to be better people to do it. There have to be people on campus who could speak to these issues a lot more clearly than I could, but I always think that somehow I'm giving back some of the hospitality that was shown to me in Ramla back there in 1985, that some of the people heard there was a Native American in the midst and bring him to their house and had these wonderful grape leaves and wonderful meals, and people would bring us into the places where they served coffee and and felt so much at home to me, and these young people opened up their lives and their hearts to me as a young person, as a college student. And we learned so much from each other, and then a couple of years later, when the first intifada broke out, it was so easy for me to see why the intifada had broken out, the first intifada, because of the frustrations that were building there amongst the young people in Palestine. So I had gained this great interest in the question of Palestine by that point, and Said was one of the people who I was reading a lot of, and when I was deciding where to go to graduate school, that was one of the things that determined it for me, was that I wanted to see if I could take class with him. And I knew that if I went to Union Seminary, which is right across the street, that I could take class at Columbia, and so I did what we did back then. I don't know if we do it at Illinois. I never have to do this in my classes. But if you took one of these really highly oversubscribed classes where everybody wants to take a class with somebody, you go to the seminar the first day and you would fill out a little index card saying, my name is Robert Warrior, I'm in a PhD program here, I want to take this class because. And there might be 100 people there the first day. We did the CEO when I was at Divinity School there. And this one would want to take classes at Columbia. And then the professor would take that big stack of index cards and choose the 16 people, the 18 people who got to take the seminar. And so I went to class the first day. And Said's assistant came in and said, you know, Professor Said wants me to winnow you down. So here, fill out these cards. And so I filled out my card. Please, please take me. Please, please, please. And I said all the things that I could about my qualifications, why I wanted to take the class. And the next day I went and my name was on the list. It had been like when I had taken class with Bill Cronin at Yale and some other ones that I had done when I was at Yale. And I was just really thrilled. So I showed up the next week. And to show you how dedicated I've been to Said as somebody whose ideas I've become attached to. At this point, he was somebody who felt that he was a target, which he was. To get to his classroom, we had to go into the International Studies building, which you had to show an ID to get into. Go up in an elevator, go into an institute where you had to show an ID again to get into the institute, then you went down to the classroom. Then 5 minutes after class was supposed to start, or a couple minutes after that, Saeed would finally show up. And after everybody was supposed to be there, and he'd stand at the door of the classroom and he'd look around to see if he knew everybody. And he'd say, "Who are you? Who are you?" And he'd say, "I'm a potential graduate student who's just here visiting, and I thought I'd sit in." He'd say, "I'm really sorry, I can't get people I don't know in the classroom." This was after the class started. That first week he just got to know us. But he walked in that first week and I choked up because I was so amazed that here was Saeed, and I was going to get to learn from him. And then we studied the works that were part of the second half of Culture and Imperialism, the novels that he reads in there, the going out chapters, the things that happened after that in that book. It was really an amazing experience, right? She wrote down furiously all the time. Until we got to some point when we were reading Moby Dick, and he was talking about Ishmael as a figure of divine election, and he said, there's Ishmael, and then there's who's his brother? It's Ishmael's brother in the Bible.
Isaac,
and then there's the third one there. So it's in the Quran. It's the it is Ishmael, right? Ishmael is the rejected son. But actually, he says, and Ishmael is the rejected son, right? So Ishmael is the rejected son. He says, "Well, not always." I say, just out of nowhere, and I go, "Oh my gosh, I just spoke. What did I speak?" But I talked about how there is this tradition in Protestantism of double election, where in fact Ishmael is not in fact rejected, is not chosen for damnation, but is elected by God in a different way, because God is love and God would never do this. God wouldn't damn anybody, so God has to choose everybody for something. And so I go, "What was that?" "Oh God, now I've got to explain this really intense theological concept." And so I tried my best, I made it through that. But what really struck me out of that seminar that I took with Saeed, that I really learned a lot from, that I would bring to all of you who are graduate students, that if you're not learning it in your graduate seminars, is this moment that would happen a lot, that may happen to you as you're sitting around coffee shops or in your seminars, when somebody would raise their hand and say something, and they'd string together one of these jargon-laden long kind of things, that graduate students tend to say. And Professor Saeed would say, "What did you mean by?" And then he would repeat back the thing that somebody had said, and they'd say, "You know, I'm talking about the way that da 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 da," and you'd say, "No, I don't know." "Well, sure, what I'm saying is that when you do this and you do that," and he'd say, "No, I really don't. And could you just stop? And just, could you tell me what it is that you're trying to communicate? Could you just tell me?" And he would really have the person just stop and just take the whole thing and lay it out. And pedagogically, it was this wonderful moment for me to say, "I'm so glad I'm not that person. I'm not the one who's having to do this thing, unpacking this really complicated idea that gets you by fine when you're sitting at Espresso Royale, right? You say it to your buddies, you say it to your cohort, and they go, "Oh, yeah, exactly." Whenever Saeed tells me, "I don't know what you're talking about." So it was really a great pedagogical moment. I still try to do this in my classes when I have people pull this on me, right? And say, "Let's stop. Let's try to figure this out." Because even if I know what you're talking about and you know what you're talking about, I'm sure there's somebody in the room who doesn't quite know what you're talking about yet. And what's the point of us having this very, this discussion that is just so filled with this kind of language where you've got to be a member of our guild in order to understand it? What are we really promoting here if that's what we're promoting? So that was a wonderful lesson for me. I also loved, really quick aside on this, we'd be in this room and somebody would be presenting, and on occasion, Professor Sayin would let a pipe and light it. And we'd all look and go, this is allowed. Just lit a pipe. And so, of course, the Columbia comp lit, and English students would pull out these galois, right? Lighting up their galois. And I'd go, well, I guess if galois, I have got Marlboro Reds, I can light up my Marlboro Red, you know? So we're smoking in class. This is great. I didn't know we could still do this. It was so different than everything else. So it was really this something that would never happen anymore. So, not this campus, but it was really I later had a class that was co-taught by Edward Said and Gene Franco. Those of you who knew any kind of Latin American studies know Gene Franco was a great Latin Americanist who could really hold her own with Edward Said. And they had another one of these. Everybody show up, fill out your card, and we'll see who gets to be in the class. 175 people showed up the first day, and they said, this is going to be a seminar. We're going to winnow this down to seminar size, which was 75 people. We had a seminar for 75 people that met in a room kind of like this one. And they stood up at the front, and every week they kind of traded off. One of them would do a 10-minute introduction. The other one would then do 5 minutes of response. I really appreciated Gene Franco because when Said would do his beginning, he would say, and Gene, I know what you're going to say. You're going to say that, well, she'd say, yes, Edward, I'm so transparent, aren't I? and so she could really hold her own. But she did on this one essay about Derrida. Derrida's thing, it was an article about Derrida writing about Tristropiques and the violence of the letter in the Americas. And she said, 75 people sitting in the room, she said, I'd like to know what Rocco Warrior thinks of this group. Wow. Oh God, what am I gonna say to all these people on across the street at the seminary? You know, I say, I just want to get the seminarians pass, right? So I don't have an opinion about this, but I have to say something. So anyway, it was all a great learning experience in the classroom. But the place where I really learned even more was in these moments when I got to go to Professor Said's office and talk to him in his office. These were always short conversations. They were usually punctuated with him being on the telephone in multiple languages other than English, so I didn't know what he was talking about. They were in Arabic, they were in French, they were in Italian, they were in something else other than what I could understand. But it was also instructive in that you would go, you'd go down the hallway and there'd be these professor's doors that were at Columbia, these nice wooden doorways. You'd be at the Said's office and there was this metal door. And it was because he was under threat, you know? And so his doorway was this ugly metal painted door. And you opened the door and it was this beautiful office. There was this anteroom office where his assistant was sitting, and it was just really grand. But boy, when you got there, you just looked at this. It wasn't a name on the doorway. I mean, it was just really kind of hidden because he just needed to feel a little more protected than he had. So when he was ready, he'd go in. And some people don't like this story when I tell it. They always think, what a bag of hot air. And I always thought, after talking to Edward Said for a few minutes about whatever you're talking to him about, he would turn around to this credenza. And he had stacks of these articles, which all turned out to be by him. And he'd say, have you read this by me? and then he'd go and he'd look at the stack again, and he'd go, what about this? Have you read this? You know, and of course what you want to say is, maybe I've read it. If I hadn't, could you just give me one of each? Because I know I'm eventually going to need that article. Just give me the whole thing, so I may not be able to come back. Right? But he'd kind of give you his prescription. It's like just showing up at the apothecary. And sure. And he'd send you off with your stack of prescriptions. He'd say, go read these. I still have these somewhere in my files, right? And it was things that are collected in Reflections on Exile. They're all in there. So these are the things that I remember that were these wonderful, wonderful things. And so he ended up playing this outsized role in my work then and since then in graduate school. A person that they saw really as a model. And when it came around to 2006, when I was writing this book that Jody mentioned, American Indian Literary Nationalism, which I brought along because there's a little bit of, that I wanted to talk about. In many ways, I think the title is a misnomer for my my contribution to it. When I got around to participating in this project, I decided to write at length about Saeed's formulations of the work of criticism as I've envisioned them, fitting into Native American and Indigenous critical studies. The book reprints a classic essay towards a national Indian literature, cultural authenticity and nationalism, which is by the Acoma poet Simon Ortiz from 1981. It's an essay that challenges Native writers and scholars to adopt a clear commitment to Native nationhood in their writing and scholarship. It has chapters by each of us three co-authors, so Womack and Weaver. I finally thought I was going to be listed first on something after having a W last name, and then I said, even though I'm W, I'm ahead of these guys, and then they said, no, we're going to have Weaver, Womack, and Warrior. I said, why? Why? I finally get to be first, and still they said, no, this is the order we're going to have. So, still last. And each of the three chapters take off in some way from Ortiz's essay. Then there's an afterword by the Abenaki scholar Lisa Brooks. The book became and has become a fulcrum point in setting critical agendas in Native literary studies, especially in the U.S., somewhat in Canada, a little bit in Indigenous literary studies beyond, although not so much there, at least yet. Ortiz's essay had come out in the journal MELIS, which some of you may know, which is Multi-Ethnic Literature of the United States, well before the internet age. And it circulated something like a cult classic via photocopying that's foreign to many of you, but there wasn't anything before the internet, when we didn't just call up things and send them by email to each other, but we had to actually, somebody had to go, how am I going to find this thing? I heard about it. I saw a quotation from it. I have three long quotations from it. I put them together into one thing, and I think I really need to get this. And so eventually somebody would convince you that the next time you had the full citation and you were in an actual real live library that had MELIS in it, you were going to dig down and get this thing out of it, right? And so that's how most of us had finally gotten it out. Ortiz in that essay lays out a clear position in favor of writers supporting the national aspirations of Native communities through their writing. As he writes, quote, the surge of literature created by contemporary Indian authors, and again this is 1981, has given a particularly nationalistic character to the Native American voice, end quote. This is something of a jarring statement as I read it 33 years later. But at the time, no one was saying anything close to this in Native literary studies, which by then was largely focused very tightly on issues of individual identity, spirituality, cultural alienation, and revival. In spite of more than a decade of intense political activism in the cities and on campuses where so much of Native studies scholarship was based, Ortiz's framing of social and political liberation was not at all du jour. So to have somebody saying, you know what, this is all actually about nation building, and it's all about nationalism, was really surprising to many people. And it really caught people up. And as I say, now it seems really jarring to say, you know what, Scott Momedy was really a nationalist. And you say, I don't really think so. But back then, it was something that was really that got people caught up. Thus, if N. Scott Mamede, James Watson, Louise Erdrich play the role of establishing Native literature as respectable, serious literature in the 70s and 80s, Gerald Visner in that same period became the apostle of experimentalism and postmodernism, Ortiz provided a rallying point for other writers, including Leslie Silko and to some extent Joy Harjo, critics and activists to identify creative work as part and parcel of Native radicalism. Ortiz's claim of finding nationalism across the range of these writers would have prompted argument from many of those whose works he purported to describe, as I've said. But it's fair to say that Ortiz's essay was among the earliest attempts, and maybe really the earliest attempt, to understand the social and political context in which Native writers do their work. Weaver and Womack, in their own ways, claim Ortiz genealogically for their own work when they update his position in American Indian Literary Nationalism. The book, in fact, began as a 20-page review by Womack of Elvira Pulitano's 2003 book, Torted Native American Critical Theory, which accused both Craig and I, it ignores Weaver, as being particularly anti-theoretical and against all forms of Eurocentric knowledge. I guess I still am against Eurocentric forms of knowledge, but not against all European forms of knowledge. Womack couldn't find a publisher for this review in our field, which is a really interesting thing about our field. One of our most important critics couldn't publish a 20-page defense of his own work anywhere, and they said, we already did a review of that book, you can't publish your essay. So I expanded it to a 40-page essay, saying, I've now written 40 pages, will anybody publish this essay? The essay circulated, and it continued to grow and get bigger. When Weaver read it, it was nearly 60 pages, and the essay prompted him to write his own long essay. He approached Womack and I, suggesting that I write an essay, so I didn't have anything, and that while they revised their complete, that I would write one to complete a three-chapter book framed around Ortiz's essay. I agreed. Their revisions brought what they had already written into a clear line with Ortiz. Weaver exploited the idea explored the idea of Native nationalism through the lens of what he called pluralist separatism, encouraging a thousand separatisms to bloom. Womack continued his relentless defense of his work against Pulitano, no doubt driving many to read her work, which was what a lot of people thought was the problem with his approach. But also modeling the importance of taking positions worth defending in a field too often that had been defined as one in which all of us as critics and scholars were looking for a single dominant way of practicing the work of criticism. So if you get criticized, you've got to go back and find the way of doing criticism, as opposed to saying, you have your way of doing it, I'm going to defend my way of doing it, you may want to continue doing it your way to some extent, and let's just have a kind of a fight back and forth, and we'll see the benefits of doing it one way or the other, and you can still do it your way, and we'll just have to, this is part of what we do, a disputation between different ways of doing things. And it depends on what you're trying to achieve in the end that will lead you to say what you're trying to get out of criticism will help you decide how you want to do criticism. And it's not as though the way I'm doing it is wrong and the way you're doing it is right, but that there's different things to be gained by different ways of doing criticism. With these other two chapters drafted, my contribution would need to fit into what was already done. And I decided for the first time to write explicitly about the impact of Said's work on how I positioned myself as a critic. Womack's relentless self-defense, I should say, reminded me of Said's quick and nimble defense of his own ideas, which if you know Said, you know that he was, you know, somebody would write a short review of his work somewhere, and he would just be on it immediately, saying, I'm going to defend myself and what somebody said about it. And I considered looking for a way to extend what Craig had done in my own chapter, because I always admired this about Said, and it was always this thing in our field where people would say, you don't want to dignify that terrible thing somebody said about you by writing about it. And I'd say, you know what, I think maybe we got to get used to being a little less dignified. That's what I liked about what Craig had done. Instead, though, I found myself wanting to come clean, though perhaps I did so too subtly even here in this book, revealing what I considered to be the underpinnings of the critical project I'd been advocating by then for over a decade. Back to my first book, Tribal Secrets, which had been the doctoral dissertation I had worked on while taking classes and in conversation with Professor Said. I'd come to understand both the historically monstrous impact of nationalism, especially though not only on the colonized world, but also the critical collective impulse it had provided to colonize stateless and dispossessed peoples under modernity. And this is the important thing to me about Said. In his writing and in his classroom, I heard Said consistently saying, as he said in this lecture tonight, that the truth of the first part of all of the terrible, awful, pernicious things about nationalism did not necessitate an abandonment of the second part. That in fact nationalism has been and will be for a long time something that people organize collectively around. So that if you're a stateless person, if you're a dispossessed person, it may in fact be that call of nationalism that prompts people to lift themselves out of the place in which they are find themselves, to to organize effectively to take themselves into a different place. The best evidence for this in Saeed's life was that for a long time he was a member of the Palestine National Congress, right? And so it was only, and it wasn't that he objected to nationalism that got him out of the PNC, but it was the PNC's politics around the Oslo Accords, in fact, that drove him out of it. And that's what happened after that was what politics like that does. That's when the PNC declared him to be persona non grata, all of his ideas terrible, and they said, your works no longer exist. And they kind of invisibilized him as an intellectual at that point. So the ugly, pernicious history of nationalist struggle, even in and especially in the colonized world, did not mean that the colonized, stateless, and dispossessed therefore had to find another basis from which to seek freedom from colonialism, that they had to find another way to find a state or repossession of what had been theirs. This is a position that causes unease whoever states it, in my experience, which is, I think, the reason for the many examples in Native and Indigenous studies of essays in the wake of American Indian literary nationalism that search for modulations in defining Native nationalism, or as commonly outright rejections of the embrace among many scholars of what's been called a nationalist critical agenda. But what's disappointed me about this has been what I saw as a rather bald-faced effort on my part to set out an alternative, and a Saeedian one at that from the start. And this is what I'll just describe as I'm kind of coming to a close, as wanting to say that I had really hidden, that I had hidden in the first work, and then I thought that I had obviated in this later work, that there was this Saeedian double move that I made, which I referred to in the first part of this title, which was this minority perspective that Saeed had held up. Which was the idea that, in fact, that you can't avoid some sort of raising of consciousness through, typically, if what you have is a national struggle, you're going to have to create national consciousness. You have to create a consciousness, a collective consciousness of some sort, that comes from within people through their collective identity. Now, that could as well come from a cultural consciousness, if what your object is a cultural object that you're creating activism and change around. It could come from a women's consciousness, if what you're creating is change around gender politics. But if it's collective, if it's the collective politics of peoplehood and creating political structures for people, territorial, structures, then it's going to have to be some form of state, possessive, national identity. But the move that Saeed makes is a double move, where I think that people then become somewhat uncomfortable who are on the national side of this, where really Saeed expresses a strong willingness to say, on the other side of this, what you have to be willing also to do is to say, as soon as or beforehand, before any of this realizes itself, you've also got to be willing to make this move into this minority perspective. You've already got to occupy this minority perspective that says, regardless of the success of the national struggle, by the time it succeeds or when it fails, by the time it changes, it modulates, it does whatever it does, by the time any of the effects of its negative effects, its ugly effects, I'm already occupying a position from which I can now be the critic that looks upon it with a critical eye. I'm now occupying a place from which I'm now part of the minority perspective on that. And that's what Saeed's minority perspective is, in fact, is occupying that place in the margins. I think that it's a non-romantic place, a non-romantic minority perspective, in fact. So that it's not, I thought a lot about this over the past several weeks, it's not the part where the person says the party's going on to celebrate the success of the national struggle, and everyone else is going to the party, and you're packing your bag to get on the train to find the next struggle. But that you might go to the party, but the next morning you're to realize it was time to leave yesterday. And it was time to leave 3 weeks ago. It was time to leave 2 years ago, or whenever it is that you're making that move. So I should have already been thinking to myself, who do I need to be next, and where do I need to be next within all of this? And it was that double move that I tried to figure in this chapter through dissent, and asking yourself constantly, not who am I, but am I in fact, and that's why I really like the focal point, focus on solidarity. Am I expressing myself in solidarity with the dissenting voices around me often enough and clearly enough that people identify me as a voice of dissent, as someone who's willing, able, and consistent in my dissent, so that they identify me with those alternative voices? That my voice isn't merely one of criticism, of complaining, of always just saying I'm here as the voice of critique, but I'm always pointing out and analyzing within, with that critical voice, that there's a reason to be critical. Because even though there's a we that is seeking redress, there's always a we that is seeking possession of that from which they've been dispossessed. That there's also a reason to say that the we is also not as inclusive as it should be, that the we has become exclusive, that the we is forgetting what it's like to be excluded in its demands on something else to be, in fact, included, to be a we. And that work will never, in fact, ever be done. I wanted to point out just a few examples of where I think this is headed within Native subjects. That would be pretty interesting to people if you've got a few minutes. Things that none of you will know yet because they're not published yet. They're published in a journal that I edit called Native American and Indigenous Studies, and we have a special forum in our issue that's coming out in a couple of months Israel-Palestine from the standpoint of Indigenous studies. This all came to our journal about a year ago, or a little bit more than a year ago. By the springtime, it was all kind of set into our journal by Eric Chaffetz, who is a professor at Cornell, and then Stephen Saleta, essay. These things came to us independently, and we put them through our editorial process. Stephen's piece was an essay that he gave us a job talk here in Illinois, and then we put it through our editorial process. It's been rewritten about 6,000 times, and then we put them together into a special forum where Stephen and Eric wrote responses to each other. So I'm advertising for the journal, but I'm also just wanting to give you a taste of what they've written as a way of seeing. This is, in fact, where I see the connection between indigeneity and indigenous studies leading us through and into these questions of the future of thinking about the nation, specifically through Israel and Palestine, and through what both of them bring up as exceptionalism in the U.S., in Israel, and Palestine. And I think what they help us do is think about where the unfinished work of Native nationalism and peoplehood is. That this question of the unfinished work of Native nationalism makes these broader questions an indigenous studies question, which is varied because of many factors, which have to do with personal identity, geography, and I think really importantly what we're finding in our program is the what we used to rely on in Native Pacific studies, as we have some people who do it, Southeastern Native Studies, or Plains Indian Studies, or United States American Indian Studies, or First Nations Studies, what I would call meta-regional syntheses, that we could say, I can pull together Native studies in the United States under the banner of U.S. policy, or First Nations studies in Canada Canadian policy. The Pacific, under a certain set of policies, habits, even a certain set of vernaculars of things that make things somewhat the same and at least recognizable across large swaths of geographies. But that now we're seeing that as those vernaculars no longer hold sway, that we need these larger frameworks, and that critique becomes one of those things that actually does pull these things together. I think that these Pacific studies, I'm looking over here at Vince and Tina because they've both been leaders in this, have helped provide an agenda. The critique of indigeneity has been one of the ways that we've been able to figure how do we pull these different threads of indigenous studies together into one larger framework. And it is through that critique that then gives us the hope of bringing something that has synchronicity to it and a simultaneity that can possibly emerge across these vast geographies. Jody's book, Transcendent Empire, that Esty brought up, is another case of that, and another reason why what has happened in indigenous studies here in Illinois has been so important. In the case of Shafe, that's what the thing I wanted to bring up from what he says in this larger essay on American exceptionalism and Israeli exceptionalism, and this comes from someone who has a daughter and grandchildren who are Israeli citizens, and who is himself a Jewish scholar, who's a Jewish American scholar. He talks about the way that he defines exceptionalism, quote, as a mode of imagining a history outside of history, as a way of reading history ahistorically in order to create a coherent narrative, one that appears to be without contradiction, that we call the nation. In particular, the exceptionalist mode functions to deny the violent displacement of indigenous peoples by settler colonialism, end quote. And then he brings up, he takes us back in a really interesting way, one which has been done before, but another one I don't think that I've seen as much. Takes us back to Philadelphia in 2008 to Barack Obama's famous speech on race from when he repudiates Jeremiah Wright and moves on into being presidential by showing that he's able to repudiate Jeremiah Wright. And he discusses these two sermons, Confusing God and Government and then the Day of Jerusalem's Fall. The Day of Jerusalem's Fall, some of you know, is one that is replete with a Zionist framework that Obama puts forward in the midst of this speech about race, which is very, very much him repudiating his own pro-Palestinian stance that he'd had as a community organizer and also as a state senator from Illinois. And I'll say a little bit about that, but the first one, Confusing God and Government, which is very much identified as a black theology of liberation sermon, is also very much something which is about indigeneity. As Chaffetz says, he said, two of the primary Jeremiah Wright sermons that led to Barack Obama's repudiation of him are connected through this definition of exceptionalism by American Indian and Palestinian histories. In Confusing God and Government, in which Wright famously said, not God bless America, but God damn America. In saying this, Wright was not expressing hatred for the United States, but was speaking prophetically. This, Chaffetz argues, quote, is not simply a condemnation of America as politicians, including most conspicuously Barack Obama, and the media played it for the public, but a Judeo-Christian call to the United States to live up to its ideals, its ideology. What could be more exceptionally America? American, end quote. So, and then to just move on to the Day of Jerusalem's Fall, Chaffetz goes on to discuss Wright's sermon as a critique of U.S. imperialism, in which Wright connects the dots between native possession, African slavery, and the U.S. support for Israeli state terrorism against Palestinians, Guatemalan genocide, and many other examples of U.S. complicity in imposing its will around the world. As he writes, quote, as Chaffetz writes, quote, American exceptionalism grounds itself in the denial of American imperialism, so that the United States can continue to represent itself without contradiction as the new world of democratic promise, just as Israel represents itself as the only democracy in the Middle East, as it enforces an apartheid regime in the territories. And so there's this completion of this, so Chaffetz pulls together through this indigenous studies lens the fullness of the right sermon into Barack Obama's ideology, into this moment of repudiation, not merely of this pro-Zionist and anti-Palestinian or even repudiation of rights views on race, but of really what he's doing overall with a worldwide repudiation of rights anti-imperialism, right? That this had been about Guatemala, this had been about Israel and Palestine, this had been about American dispossession of Native America, it had been about slavery, it had been about all of these things. And what all did Obama have to do? What all did he have to lay on the table in Philadelphia in 2008 in order to make himself acceptable as a candidate? And then Chaffetz moves on to the 2009 inaugural address and then shows, which I won't do here, but he shows how all of this plays itself out in that very stark, very minimalist language of the inaugural address in this really depressing way of showing how these things all connect together. In that same forum in the talk, to move on to Salida, in that same forum and in the talk he gave as part of his on-campus interview for American Indian Studies in early 2013, Stephen Salida discussed the ways in which American Indian Studies and Palestine Studies were not only increasingly intersecting, but finding the need to construct infrastructures to assist those navigating that intersection. This was in part, he argued, because of, quote, the proliferation of blogs and social media where people are able to argue, inform, share, and theorize, however superficially or in some cases with sophistication. These platforms lend themselves to all sorts of comparisons, usually for the sake of rhetorical persuasion, end quote. In a statement that now reads as prescient and perhaps even chilling, he goes on to say, quote, the benefits and detriments of social media to activism and scholarship are wide-ranging and much contested, so it's difficult to quantify exactly how influential new media have been on the proliferation of comparison among natives and Palestinians. Social media platforms, however, document the extent to which the comparison has entered into the consciousness of a certain demographic, that of the intellectual engaged in public discourse around decolonization, end quote. The mere proliferation of claims of indigeneity, Salida argues, are not the basis upon which to build new bridges of inquiry within Native and Indigenous studies. Indeed, as he and Chaffetz point out quite independently of each other, such claims have often been made in attempts to legitimize both Israeli and Palestinian narratives of regional land. So, to bring things to a close, which would be kind of a thud of a close, I think, hopefully there's been enough unthuds to make up for the thud of a close that I'll provide on this. So, good, along the way, we see all of these connections, all of these things that bring us back to the Saeed from 2088 to 2000. The Saeed throwing the rock, the Saeed in the classroom, the Stephen Salida on campus, and where he is now, where we are now. Along the way, we see and learn the prevalence and the persistence of what Saeed calls lost causes. What he saw in this essay in 1993, if you haven't read it, is really a kind of a downer of an essay, but it shows him in this vulnerable moment where it's not long after he's been diagnosed with leukemia, not long after the Oslo Accords, when you can tell he's a little bit down in the dumps, it seems like to me, to do some psychoanalysis, and where he talks about what it is to take up this idea of lost causes. And all of us have been there, right? I mean, all of us have been in that place where we see and feel those lost causes. I promised myself I would say this at some point tonight. All of us have even felt at times that the University of Illinois is a lost cause, and who could blame us for feeling that way at some point? but there's this also there's this important moment within this that I think is the moment of exploration for me that I won't go into tonight. That's a suggestive moment that I want to still, even though I wrote about it 8 years ago in this essay, that still bears investigation, still bears thinking through, that has been brought up, I think, through Stephen's work, through Eric Chapin's work, continuing through Saeed's work, about Saeed's beginning that essay talking about Hawaiian natives, Australian aborigines, and gypsies, as he says, and that these are the lost causes that it's easy to think, these are the things that it's easy to say we'll never have a chance again. And are they worth thinking about? Because they're really these lost causes. But then again, maybe they'll come around again. And so who are we to call them lost causes in the first place? So he's not necessarily saying that's a lost cause, stop thinking about it. But he uses them as the examples that will be familiar to everybody. So by the end, I think that you can see, because he does talk about Native American issues specifically towards the end of the essay, and this isn't so much psychoanalysis as it is a way of reading deeply into the text. I'm really not doing psychoanalysis because it's not my deal, but a way of a close reading in the text of there being this hesitation for him to enter into that indigenous space that reminds him of, in fact, this Native American space from which there is so little room to argue for political viability. There's so little room to do anything except to go to a very powerful government as a very weak partner to demand anything except from a moral standpoint. And it's easy to see why Saeed is hesitant to enter that space. And yet, it's also interesting to think about what is available within that space that may not be available within that space that he's almost nostalgically looking back on from the 1970s, when he, the late 60s and early 70s, when he entered Palestinian politics, when Palestinian politics was part of the Third World Movement, when everything was about, in fact, gaining status, gaining a state, gaining this very big sense of peoplehood. And that thing that he says in the end that rescues the article, and that for me at least, is that, let me find it really quickly because he says it. And this will be where I stop. So for Saeed in the end, that sense of something being a lost cause is countered by the political imagination and critical consciousness that is, quote, a means of affirming the individual intellectual vocation, which is neither disabled by a paralyzed sense of political defeat nor impelled by groundless optimism and illusory hope. So that for Saeed in the end, there's never something that is finally a lost cause, but it's something always that can be returned to, that can be picked up again. Which is, I think, by 2003, when we see him here, he's, even though just months away from his death, in a very different space than he was when he's writing about lost causes, in picking up this, with real gusto, this sense of critique, this sense of speaking truth to power. What I had said at the end of this essay, which I'll give away the ending in hopes that you'll read the whole thing sometime. Native intellectuals on this continent have been vying in the arena Saeed describes already, many of them for a long time. While I wished for him while alive and wished for his people, the Palestinians, now a better result than they have as of yet been able to achieve in regaining power in their homelands, I also welcome them to our world, the fourth world. May a new world of justice focus the energies of our intellectual lives. May a new world of justice in our nations be ever in our grasp. Thank you.
is a very complicated. I'm not sure that I understood everything, but I was very impressed with this notion of this double move of studies that you seem to portray. I'm wondering how that works, how one does that. I mean, that seems like an extraordinary, difficult thing to do, because you're not just sort of saying that in the very moment that a movement produced to be contestatory and difficult wins, that then you have to sort of switch sides or find the next excluded group or something like that. You're sort of saying that it's as we are becoming we, that is, even in the process of being there's already exclusions going on, that you have to, how do you sort of say, yes, we've got to fight, and then at the same time say, but look, there's also, we cannot exclude these. How do you do that?
Well, I think it comes down to individual, what I said at the very end, these individual vocations and the ideas of them. I think for Said it becomes easier because he doesn't sign up to become a government representative of something, right? So he doesn't, I mean, somebody might ask him to say, you'd be a great minister of culture in the new government. And I think he would say, I don't think I can do that. I think from his point of view, he'd say, I don't think I would do that. I would be a terrible minister of culture because I would have to resign after 2 weeks because I couldn't accept it. You can name the conservatory music at the, at the new university after me, which would be great, which they did. But me being the minister of education or the minister of culture, running a bureaucracy and having to actually do that work, I'm a critic, I'm not a bureaucrat. I think he has been accused, and he, or at least would be taken to task on that point of view to say, this is where somebody could say, but then you're taking an easy way out as a critic, right? What about all the hard work that needs to be done within a movement that makes the transition from being a movement into being a government, being a movement, or into being something that actually serves people from the inside instead of the outside. I think that consistently Said at least makes it clear that there's a place for criticism, and he wants to occupy that place, and that regardless of what he wants, that there needs to be a living life of criticism that goes on as part and parcel of any national life, and that to the extent that that is not present, that you don't have national life. But I think that those questions for other people who are less resolute or less clear about that, and I'm afraid I would find myself more in that position, and I guess I have at times. I was thinking a lot during this, during the couple of weeks that I had to think about putting this together of the different ways that the different registers. I wanted to fill out more about being able to say, as a scholar in Native studies with these different sized multiple communities in which we find ourselves speaking to simultaneously. I might find myself as an Osage with a relationship to a tribal community that has a stable yet ineffective and sometimes corrupt tribal government. At the same time that I find myself having a relationship by a relationship of affiliation with that group that I'm born into, and then having a lot of knowledge about a group that needs that is, let's say, on our campus, where we have a relationship with the Peoria tribe of Oklahoma, and I know that community somewhat for another reason in another context. And then I have and that's a group that's very small and has a different set of needs. And then a group that is seeking recognition from the U.S. government. And then I have friends in another place that, I'm in solidarity with people who are seeking a state. And then I really care about Bolivia, which is a totally different kind of thing. And I'm trying to think about all these different things at once But when it comes down to where I could have an impact, let's say back home among the Osages, what would I do if our current chief, Jeff Standing Bear, asked me to occupy a spot within his government? What would I do? And would I, I'd want to say no, but I don't know if I would, because it'd be kind of saying no to something that needs to be done. And who, you know, what would be my rationale for saying no, right? And then when that job isn't done well, what's my rationale for not doing, pitching in and doing that work? Because we need a critic, right? And so, you know, it's really hard to, it's a hard question to ask. And I think if you think about a question like Bolivia, it becomes difficult. Although there, I think you can see, that's a situation that has really needed some critics, along with a lot of really good people willing to pitch in and do their part in making the bureaucracies work, the ministries work, and the local, the whole thing. It becomes stretched, right? And the government there becomes stretched. But it is, I don't think it's not an easy answer. I think it's complex. I wish it was easy, but it's not. I don't know if you have more thoughts on
it. No.
First, a comment. Listening to the video clip of Salit's presentation and then your own, I can already see a fruitfulness in the dialogue between the Palestinian experience and struggle and that of Native Americans, which obviously makes me really mad that we deprived of the opportunity of Sarita being here. But my question, prefaced by this comment, is the Native American struggle, or if you put it in the context of literature, literary nationalism, internationalist. The reason I'm asking this is, before, I'm from Uganda, before I came to the United States, I didn't know anything about Native American struggles. As far as the average Ugandan, and I dare say African consciousness is concerned, Native Americans have been done with. They probably don't even exist. So, where does your struggle lie in the landscape of internationalist struggles?
Mm-hmm. That's a big question in and of itself, but it's a great question, I think, to ask in the context of the international question, which I think we can only, I mean, I think that the question is more profoundly. One that we can ask now in a way that was harder to ask even 20 years ago, because there's a larger presence of primarily Anglophone, but not only Anglophone, indigenous peoples from around the world doing work that's similar to each other. So that in our program in American Indian Studies, we do have Native Pacific Studies. We pay attention to Native Studies. Mexico, Central and South America, so not primarily in Anglophone settings. But I think that it's an enormous gap to be bridged to create ways of conceptually making Native American struggles legible across the divide between Africa and North America, especially also between Asia and Native America, which have been the two very large places where they haven't been as legible, right? And so it's been part of the difficulty. I'd like to see us be able to do more of that. I think one of the things that I would say, just even as you formulated the question, something I've dealt with off in my head about. Something I didn't say that was really central to what I wanted to say, which was that I had disavowed the idea of literary nationalism even in the book, which had been part of what say in even in the discussion after the book came out, and even in the talk tonight, where I always forget to say it, which is, I never believed in literary nationalism, but I was like Said, somebody who believed in, I could be an Osage nationalist, and I couldn't understand what a literary nationalist would be. It sounded like terrible literature. You know, it just sounded like something that, that could be appropriated by, literature could be appropriated by a nationalist. But to sit down and specifically write something from a nationalist point of view, we would end up with, usually, crappy literature. But I think that the place that I've seen the bridge happen, the bridge built best has been in the area, at least for me personally, it's been in the area of philosophy and understanding the way that African philosophers have been able to take African concepts and philosophy work in the formulation of hybrid and non-hybrid forms of African philosophical ideas, and see something similar happening in the United States. More often than political theory and philosophy, but I certainly gained something from that. To me, I think it's an area of incommensurability in trying to understand how you would come up with a meeting place for African colonialism and Native American experience. Even though you would find a lot of common ground in some places where you would find, let's say, a lot of recognition at the level of people who have, let's say, in the African context, concepts of village life and modern village life, and urbanization, recent urbanization. But then you can also get a lot of static, which happened last year. I'm reminded of meeting with our provost. meeting with our provost, who is a reasonably a pleasant person, but you know, we were meeting with the chief of the Peoria Nation, and he was trying to talk about, well, you know, where I'm from, I'm a chief, and I thought, you know, everybody's a chief. It's just like wherever you go, I'm not a chief. I'm just a person, and you know, and among the Osages, I'm just a person. I'm from a respectable family of people, but I'm certainly not from a leadership family. Wow, imagine that the provost is also a chief. And I thought it was maybe it's true. For all I know, it's true. But it didn't seem to me that he was saying the other things it would say. The way that other people that I know from, especially from West Africa, who talk about their experience of moving back and forth between family and the city and in the village, how they would go back and visit their relatives, and that they would. They were talking about something that seemed very familiar to me in being able to go back to our reservation in Oklahoma. And what I talked about with people on the West Bank and visiting hospitality. And while there would be millions upon millions of people who had lost that kind of connection to that kind of village life, there would be other ways that it continued in the city, right? That those forms of connection, affiliation is termed in the forms of affiliation to use Saidian language. But once we get to the level of governance, government policy, towards the continuation of a certain kind of native life, we run into some differences between the two continents, also between South America and North America, or really between Latin America. I wish that we had more opportunities to actually discuss that particular question.
I don't know whether I can actually formulate this question clearly or not, but when you're talking about the minority imperative and how it seems to me that what you're suggesting is that it has to be done at the moment of success or right afterward. But the way I can look at it, or I look at it, is that maybe by then it's too late.
Right.
And my narrative imperative has to happen while the struggle is going on.
Right.
Otherwise, it's very hard to occupy that space afterwards.
Right.
And just wanted to know what you think of it.
I think so, and then I think that it's also something that also has to be done authentically and has to be done in a way that, that makes sense, that isn't, I think that, just because it's the Saeed lecture, I'll keep talking about Saeed, that I think that he was haunted by Fanon in my interactions with him, and haunted by the picture in Fanon of the intellectual who is caught grasping at the robes of the clothing of the people, but not ever being able to actually get wrapped up in the struggles of the true revolutionaries, right, at the grassroots level. And so the minority imperative was not that, was not actually trying to be in that place, but was actually to try to find yourself in, to find yourself with that perspective of understanding that that's where you needed to be, even if you weren't that. And I think that I thought that was so important to him because, you know, I've heard these criticisms of Saeed saying, how could somebody who loved the idea of the contrapuntal so much also love grand opera so much when there's nothing contrapuntal about grand opera or about so much of the music that he liked? Listen to Daniel Barenboim and these other things that he loved. They weren't experimental, they weren't contrapuntal, they were just classic music. And say, you know, but it was the music he loved. And so he loved that music, he loved that opera, and he enjoyed it. And so he wanted it, it gave him pleasure, it gave him more life and more enjoyment, and there's nothing wrong with that. And so I think that there was that kind of authenticity within seeking out that kind of minority perspective that he found was his imperative. But I think that it's the imperative part, and feeling the imperative, and whenever it happens, following it, right? So you may discover that you're 3 weeks late, or 3 years late, or 2 years early. But that it's important to the imperative is the important part, and then following it and saying, I should have packed my bag last week, and you in fact figure out that you packed your bag too early or whatever. I don't know. It's a terrible metaphor, maybe, but that you've shown up, that you left the revolution too early. So what? You know, it was important that you followed that sense of the imperative, and that you followed that critical imperative that you felt, and that you went ahead and did it. You're 3 years too late. You know, forgive yourself. Just move on and do it, because it's important that you eventually do it. That it's not the worst thing you ever did to be too late. You know, it's better than never having realized the mistake at all. I think the imperative, but the feel of that imperative, I think that some people feel that imperative every day of their lives and never ever follow it, right? And they say, I really should, and then they don't follow through on it. I remember when this August, when Asif and I finally got to sit down and be in the same room with each other, and it just, you know, I felt this kind of impact. I really need to talk. Asif just seems interesting, you know. We were in the same room with each other for about 20 minutes, and I just said, I should have met this guy so long ago. He's been on campus for so long, you know. And then he said some things, and I just said, this was silly. I should have been really relating to this person a long time before, you know. And
it was
just
a bad meeting.
Yeah, you know, and so, you know, it was just like that thing where I just said, this should have happened a long time ago. Thank goodness it happened right then, because it was really an important time for that to happen.
So I'm figuring out the
Okay, well, great. I'm ready. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all.